Borthakur IAS Academy, an endeavor of excellence.
Borthakur IAS Academy.
Hello everyone, welcome to Borthakur IAS Academy, Northeast's premier institute for UPSC, APSC and NPSC preparation. I'm your friend Atrey, and today we will be analyzing all the important news and updates dated 8th of May 2021 only on Current Affairs 365. Please like and share this video, and also don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. I hope you all are doing really well. And now let's get started with today's news. So the first news of today is about the unique disability ID. Each of the state and union territory, they have been asked by the central government to grant certificate of disability through online mode using this portal of unique disability ID from 1st of June. And this has been done by the Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities under Government of India. The central government, they have already notified the rights of persons with disabilities rules, okay? And under the rule number 18.5, it mandates that the central government should make it compulsory for all the states and union territory authorities to issue certificate only through this online mode. And this project has been under implementation since 2016. The main objective of this project is to provide genuine information about the disabled people, okay, so that the certificate which is issued, it becomes valid throughout the country. And also this will simplify the process for giving benefits to the Divyangans, that is physically challenged people. The second news is about an eco-sensitive zone which has been recently declared by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change around the Thane Creek Flamingo Sanctuary at Maharashtra. Now, this particular news is important from biodiversity and environment subtopic, okay, and it will be tagged under GS Paper 3. What is an eco-sensitive zone? It acts as a buffer for protected areas and reduced developmental pressure around the wildlife sanctuary or national park. We will discuss about eco-sensitive zones in detail, okay? But first, let us have a look at the Thane Creek Flamingo Sanctuary. This sanctuary is the second marine sanctuary of Maharashtra after the Malwan Sanctuary and has a reputation of to be recognized as an important bird area, as it is home to around 167 species of birds like flamingos. The Thane Creek, it is an inlet in the shoreline of Arabian Sea, which isolates the city of Mumbai from mainland India. This creek has been divided into two parts and it was formed originally due to certain seismic faults. Now, these eco-sensitive zones, as I have already mentioned, they act as buffer zones, right? These are the ecologically fragile areas, which also includes areas within 10 kilometer around the national parks, wildlife sanctuaries or any other such protected areas. And in case there are certain sensitive corridors, okay, or connectivity with other ecologically important patches, then even the areas beyond 10 kilometers will also be included in the eco-sensitive zone. The ministry which is responsible for designating a particular location as eco-sensitive zone is the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And this notifies under the Environment Protection Act of 1986, right? What is the objective behind choosing a particular place as an eco-sensitive zone? It is mainly done to regulate certain activities that takes place around such ecologically fragile ecosystem, okay, and also the protected areas nearby. Now, coming to the regulation of activities in the eco-sensitive zones, there are certain activities which are permitted, certain activities are regulated, and others are prohibited, okay. Now, we will see which activities are permitted, regulated, and prohibited in the eco-sensitive zones. First, coming to the permitted activities, any ongoing agriculture or horticulture practice, rainwater harvesting, certain adoption of green technologies, okay, for activities, all these kind of actions are permitted in the eco-sensitive zones, okay. then felling of trees, establishment of hotels and resorts, commercial use of water, drastic change of agricultural system, or any adoption of heavy technology, okay, these kind of activities are regulated. They will need prior permission, okay, before implementing such activities in or around the eco-sensitive zone. And thirdly, the prohibited activities, it includes commercial mining, development of industries which will cause pollution like air, water, soil, noise, etc. Establishment of any major hydroelectric project, tourism activities like hot air balloons over the national parks, then discharge of effluents or any solid waste which are hazardous to the nature, okay, all these kind of activities will be strictly prohibited in the eco-sensitive zones and also in areas around the eco-sensitive zone. The significance of this particular initiative is mainly to minimize the impact of urbanization and other developmental activities in the areas which are adjacent to the protected areas. And it acts as a, these eco-sensitive zones, they are designed in such a way that they can act as a shock absorber. They also act as a transition zone from the areas of high protection to the areas involving lesser protection. And in turn, the eco-sensitive zone, they helps in situ conservation of the organisms, right? For example, the conservation of one-horned rhinos of Kaziranga National Park in Assam. These zones also minimizes the forest depletion and man-animal conflict. However, there are certain challenges which are involved in setting up of eco-sensitive zone and also their preservation, right? First is climate change. Because of the rising global temperature, the water and ecological stress in this eco-sensitive zones increases, okay? And that's why they cannot be maintained in the way in which they should have been, okay? And secondly, the interference of local communities. They practice the slash and burn techniques in agriculture, okay? The population can also increase pressure in the particular region, right? Rapidly use the resources, which includes firewood, forest produce, etc., which exerts extra pressure in the protected areas. So these are the challenges which are included in when it comes to protection and preservation of the eco-sensitive zones. The next news is regarding the 5G trial, which has been approved by the Department of Telecommunication of our country. Okay, and it has given permissions to all the telecom service providers for conducting trials of its use and application. What will this particular trial bring? It will formally leave out all the Chinese companies like ZTE or Huawei from the 5G race in India. There are certain restrictions which other countries have put on such Chinese network providers. Okay, India has not officially launched any kind of such official limitations on these Chinese companies, but after starting its own 5G trial, this is definitely going to impact the business of these Chinese companies here in India. Now, coming to the 5G technology, there are certain features which are included in this 5G technology, and this is expected to bring to trigger the fourth industrial revolution, right? The 5G technology, if you have heard about it, then you will know that it mainly works in three bands, namely the low, mid and high frequency, and all these spectrum, they have their own uses as well as limitations. First, let's see what is the low band spectrum. As the name suggests, it provides internet speed within of a particular limit, which is up to 100 Mbps megabits per second, and it shows great promise in terms of coverage and the speed of internet and data exchange, but the limitation is its speed, okay, that is 100 Mbps. And the mid-band spectrum, it offers comparatively higher speeds than the low band, but here the limitation is in terms of its coverage and also penetration of signals. And finally, coming to the high-band spectrum, it has the highest speed of all the three bands, but has extremely limited coverage and signal penetration strength. The 5G, it is the latest upgrade in the long-term evolution mobile broadband networks as well. This will provide high internet speed and efficiency, okay? And it will work up to three times greater efficiency and low latency. Latency is the amount of time the data takes to travel between the source and its destination. Now coming to the trials, the initial phase the trials will be organized for a period of 6 months, and it will also include the 2 month preparatory time which is required for setting up of the equipment. All the telecom service providers, they will test the setup in urban, semi-urban as well as rural areas. And the application of the 5G technology, it will include in the sectors of telemedicine, tele-education, virtual reality, drone-based agricultural monitoring, etc. And all the data which will be generated from these trials, they will be stored in India. As I have already mentioned about the Chinese telecom companies in India, right, like ZTE, Huawei, etc. These will be left out by the Indian telecom ministry, and India will become the latest country to lock out these firms. According to US, Huawei has been used by China for spying, okay, via its 5G equipment. And so the US telecommunication companies, they have removed Huawei equipment from their network. However, India is yet to implement any such type of official ban on the Chinese companies, because they are currently supplying a significant amount of equipment to the India's mobile provider. But with this particular step of locking out the Chinese equipment makers, our government has signaled a tighter and more security oriented approach to our country's network, okay? And it is widely expected to work against the Chinese company. So the next news is another important news under GS paper 3, which will be a part of biodiversity and environment. A report was released recently by the Climate and Clean Air Coalition and United Nations Environment Program, which titled as Global Methane Assessment, Its Benefits and Costs of Mitigating Methane Emission. This particular report, it suggested that the world needs to cut down the methane emissions very significantly in order to avoid any climate related changes in the upcoming future. Okay. So first of all, what is methane? It is one of the simplest hydrocarbon having a chemical formula of CH4. This particular gas is a powerful greenhouse gas, and it is flammable in nature, and that is the reason why it is used as a fuel worldwide. Methane is mainly produced by the breakdown of organic material, and it can be introduced in the atmosphere either by natural processes or by human activities. Natural process will include the decay of plant materials in wetlands, seepage of gas from underground deposits, okay, or from the digestion of food by cattle. Whereas the human activities include oil and gas production, rice farming, or waste management. Methane is considered to be 84 times more potent than carbon and does not last as long in the atmosphere before it breaks down, which is why it is responsible for creating ground level ozone, which is a dangerous air pollutant. Now, why methane is causing so much of a problem is that ever since human beings have started keeping a record of the methane emissions since the 1980s, its emissions are increasing every year. Okay. Although carbon dioxide emissions levels dropped during the COVID-19 pandemic because of lockdown, but the presence of methane in atmosphere, it has reached record levels in the last year. This is a matter of huge concern, because around 30% of global warming since the pre-industrial time, it is because of presence of methane or increasing methane emissions, right? So first, in order to reduce the quantity of methane or the methane emissions, we'll have to work on the major sources of methane, right? The major sources of methane includes fossil fuel. As I have already mentioned, oil and gas extraction, okay, it accounts for around 23% of the methane emission in case of the fossil fuel sector. Along with it, coal mining accounts for around 12%, another extra 12% of emission. Waste, landfills and waste water, they made up of around 20% of emissions from the waste sector. And the waste sector, it could cut its methane emission by improving the disposal of sewage around the world. Disposal of sewage or disposal of waste material is one of the main major source of pollution, right? Be it air, water, or soil. Also from agricultural sector, the livestock emissions from manure and enteric fermentation, it roughly constitutes around 32% of methane emission, and rice cultivation accounts for additional 8% of it. In India, the greatest potential to reduce methane sector emission is from the waste sector. If we control our waste sector, if we mainly, dedicate ourselves in waste segregation and proper management of the waste materials, then that can significantly reduce the methane emissions in our country. The human-caused methane emission, they must be cut down by around 45% in order to protect ourselves from the worst effects of climate change in the near future. There are certain initiatives which India has been taking, okay, like the seaweed-based animal feed, which aims to reduce the methane emissions from cattle and boost the immunity of cattle and poultry. The India Greenhouse Gas Program, undertakes measures to manage the greenhouse gas emissions and builds a comprehensive measurement and management strategies for reducing the emissions. Okay, the National Action Plan on Climate Change is there, and also the Bharat Stage 6 norms. India shifted from the Bharat Stage 4, BS4, to the BS6 stage for maintaining the emission norms. So these are all the initiatives which India has been taking since so long, but as we all know, we have to work a lot on it because we have to cut the methane emission caused by human by 45%. So it is not just the responsibility of one country, but the entire world, okay, all the nations of the world, we need to join hand and work on cutting down the methane emissions from all the sources possible. India can work on its waste management sector, and the countries like China, Africa, Europe, they can also work significantly, right? Africa needs to work on its livestock and oil and gas management because the greatest potential of methane emission in Africa comes from these sectors. Then China needs to work significantly in the coal production and livestock sectors. So this will be a global effort, okay? This needs to be a global effort in order to bring down the methane emissions so that in near future we don't have to face the worst effects of methane emission in the environment. Moving ahead to the next place which is in news these days, okay? It is about Afghanistan's Dala Dam. It is Afghanistan's second biggest dam, which has been recently captured by Taliban after months of fierce fighting. This dam was constructed in the year 1952 and is built on the Arghandab River, and which is located in the Kandahar province of Afghanistan. So this was all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope it was useful for you all. I'll see you all again on Monday with another session of Current Affairs, only at Borthakur's IAS Academy, Northeast's premier institute for UPSC, APSC and NPSC preparation. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.
Borthakur IAS Academy. Prastuti aru adhyayanor nirbhorjoggyo thikona. Borthakur IAS Academy.